Hi there, Jamie Goode here, wineandrack.com. Tasting wine on camera. This time, I'm going to Chile. Chile is a country I like visiting. It's pretty cool. It's pretty. It's got lovely natural conditions for growing wine grapes. But sometimes the wines don't always deliver the sort of diversity and interest that you'd expect given the terroirs they have, which seem to be very good. So I think Chile does a really, really great job at the bottom end of the market where it offers great value for money, but sometimes it struggles really to establish itself at the fine wine end of the market. And, you know, even in that upper mid-range, the wines contemporaries sometimes say it's very Chilean, not in a positive way. So I keep an open mind though, and I keep coming back and trying more wines, and I think there are some changes taking place. And this is a wine that I was really interested to try because I interviewed the winemaker, Marcelo Papa, a while back. It's the Marques de Casa Concha Cabernet Sauvignon 2014 from Maipo, which is one of the most famous regions in Chile. And it's part of the Concha y Toro stable. Now, Concha y Toro, the biggest wine company in Chile, makes some really good quality wines. And it's good for Chile that Concha y Toro do such a good job because it really matters, I think, for a wine country to have big companies that perform well. And they did perform well. So this wine, it's not an expensive wine. By Chile standards, it's reasonably expensive. It's in the sort of 10 to 12 pound range, maybe the 12 to 14 pound range. But it's one of those wines that you often pick up in a supermarket a little bit cheaper than that. And the thing about this wine is that it's made from vineyards, you know, I think there's around 80 hectares of vineyards that form the core of this wine. So it's not massive by Chile standards, but it's a reasonable size. And Marcelo Papa has, over the last few years, been taking back some of the winemaking. He's decided to pick a bit earlier, sometimes about to a month earlier. He's moving from small barrels to large Italian botti. Now, these are big oak casks that take many times more wine than a barrel would. And they seem to mature and age a wine in a much less interventionist sort of way than small barrels can. So this is kind of like 2 years into his intervening and pulling back the ripeness and moving from small oak to larger oak. So it's still the sort of transition phase, but this is going in the sort of direction he wants to take this wine. So we'll see what it's like. This first thing I note on the nose is that it tastes distinctly less Chilean than this wine would have done in the past. There's lovely, pure, fresh blackcurrant fruit, some raspberries, some cherries. It's quite aromatic and floral. It's not overdone, it's not heavy, it's not intense. In the mouth, yes, there's some fruit sweetness. I mean, this is a reasonably warm climate. But there's a freshness as well, there's a vitality. There's bright cherry fruit. There's a bit of grip. It's not giving everything away immediately, but also it's a lovely purity as well. We still get that sort of blackcurranty raspberry core that you find with Chilean Cabernet Sauvignon, but there's also a bit more to it than that. There's a sappiness, freshness. It's not lean and unripe, but it's not overripe. And it isn't grippy and angular and a bit constricted in and on itself like some of the Chilean Cabernets can be. Best of all, it doesn't taste too Chilean. And I don't mean that in a harsh way. I just think that some of the Chilean reds, before you taste anything else, before you taste a place, and I know Chile is a place, but it's a very big place, before you taste all that, you taste the fact that it's Chilean. Boom. Impact, Chilean. Edges, angles, not really the thing I always want to drink. This, though, is supple, it's fresh, it's got drinkability. It's got generosity to the fruit, not too much, but it's got enough to kind of invite you in. But it's moving really in a very interesting direction, away from the past in Chile. And Marcelo was saying that when he makes this wine, he doesn't have to add all his nutrients, he doesn't have to add the same stuff that he used to have to add in the past. He didn't have to, because he's picking earlier, the fermentations actually carry themselves through. much more easily without so much intervention. So it's a sort of win-win scenario. You end up with a wine that tastes more interesting, you're putting less stuff into the wine to make the fermentation take place the way you would like. It's a supple, sappy, fresh, vital Cabernet Sauvignon. It's still noticeably the new world, but it's not so much so. This is taking Chile and bringing it back a little bit. And I think this is, as Marcello progresses over the next vintage or two, what you're going to see is a wine that's actually quite classic, a wine that you can take and cellar and see it develop over many years. And the best thing is that this is not super expensive. This is really very affordable. And I love that when you can buy an interesting wine that's affordable. And it's time for me to kind of get over my Chile prejudice and start embracing the more interesting, more naturally made, the fresher wines from Chile. Anyway, that's my view. A good wine, a work in progress, but it's going in the right direction. Thanks for watching.